Frankie Keeley, and the one and only Carl Fogarty.
Woo!
You two go and... There you go. So, lads, look at my audience, eh? It's a bit different than the bike hall, isn't it? A lot more people here. You all right with the lights? Yes? Yeah,
fine.
Good. Yeah, it's all working. Yeah, it's all working. So, here we go. Look at that. Frankie, I know you've made a long journey to get here. You've come all the way over from Italy. You enjoying it so far?
Yeah, I enjoy a lot. In 7 days, I already been here in England 2 times, so it's like my second home.
It's like your second home being back here in the UK. That's fabulous. Nice of you to say so. Frankie, where did it all start for you? When did you first start getting on a motorbike and being competitive?
It's something we have in the blood, I think, and I'm very pleased. I'm very pleased to start in racing, and I'm very lucky to do it because many people maybe are faster than me, but don't have the same chance than I got. My uncle racing in World Championship already, and I was very young following. And that gave me a passion, and at the end I came a rider.
Fantastic. And yeah. Carl, what about you? When did it all begin for you?
Quite a while ago now, actually. My dad used to race bikes, so I was kind of brought up with it, as probably a lot of people know. So that was it, really. It was in the blood. I think had he played golf or cricket, I might have ended up playing one of them sports, heaven forbid, but there you go. I was brought up with bikes. Used to go to the TT, that was like a family holiday for us, you know. Remember, I used to cry my eyes out on the boat on the way home, knowing I'd got to go back to school the day after and stuff. So, for me, it was just being brought up around it with my dad, racing around all the place and going with him, so... It was just, you know, what I wanted to do from a very, very young age.
So you always knew you wanted to be on two wheels, go racing bikes?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Like I said, whatever you get brought up with, the chances are you're going to end up doing that, and that was the case for me. But, I remember going to, like I said, to the Isle of Man and stuff and watching my dad race and thinking, God, I want to win the TT and things like that, and then obviously going on from there to the World Championships and stuff. But, absolutely, that's the only thing I wanted to was race bikes.
Frankie, for you, tell us a little bit about your progression, because you started off in smaller classes, 125, 250, and then built your way up to get to World Superbikes. Just tell us in a nutshell about that progression.
Yeah, starting with 125 was normally for every young guy, and step by step, in 2-3 years time, I win European Championship in 1985, and step a little bit too much, because I go in a World Championship with a 500, and was not also a world team. I have to learn a lot of things, keep some time, and after I was fast also with a 500. Drop down in 250 class at beginning of the year 90, and at the end I find my proper life in a superbike from 1995 to 2006.
1995 to 2006 is when you ended up in Superbikes. But Carl, I can remember standing at the Cragney Bar watching you come past almost sideways at every opportunity you got on the Isle of Man. And you had a fantastic career in the TT.
I did, yeah. That Cragney Bar, is that near Cragney Bar?
Cragney Bar, yeah. I call it Cragney Bar.
Yeah, no, I had some fantastic times though. You know, like I said, it's, you know, one of those places I wanted to win at, and because I was brought up around the place, and I had some massive battles around there, and I managed to win the race, and on my last ever visit there 20 years ago now, I set the lap record, which was for, you know, I think it was 7 years, so yeah, good memories from that place. I look back on my career now, and I think there was a happy times, more fun memories that I have before it got, you know, big serious stuff with the TV and, you know, sponsors and all that kind of stuff, in obviously World Superbikes became massive, but I think it's kind of like the good old days when you're just kind of starting out, and you're not professional, and you're in the back of a van, and you know, even go out the night for a few drinks to your mates and stuff, and then get on the bike and race after it. So I think it's changed a bit now.
Yeah, it has changed a bit. We were talking about this in the bike hall that, these days you see the Formula One drivers, when they finished out the cars, they go and do that little awkward bit where they put their watches on and they put their baseball cap on. They almost feel like they don't want to talk to each other.
They're all robots. I want to thank the Lord Jesus Christ and all that kind of stuff, first of all. But I've got to watch what I was saying. I'm sat in a car show, I guess, but they don't seem to be allowed to be. I don't think it's their fault, really. People like Lewis Hamilton, I think, fantastic, talented guy. Probably, for me, he's the best guy in the world in a car. But they've got a job to do. I think someone's pulling the strings behind them all the time. They're not like back in my day. I mean, I hated everybody. I think everybody hated me. But they're all big characters who weren't afraid to say what was on your mind. You know, weren't afraid to do anything. But now, I just feel that you're not allowed to be a personality in a lot of ways. Yeah. I think it's because it's all the sponsorship thing and TV.
That's your car starts a lot
better, mate. Starring in a reasonably priced car. But yeah, it's just changed a bit. You know, there's not, you know, back even when the Formula One back in the day, we used Prost and Senna's and Mansell's, who were big characters. And I think you probably miss out, don't you? You're not missing out on big characters. You don't really care about who they upset, what they did. You know what I mean? But in my sport, it has changed a lot, and they are very sort of, you know.
And what about you two back in the day? I mean, Frankie, did you and Carl used to sort of say hello to each other? Could you stand there and have a beer together? Or was there a rivalry? Did you absolutely hate each other? You wanted to beat each other on and off the track?
Frankie loved me, I hated him.
Of course, we was friendly when we meet for the race. We have a drink. We spend time together, but maybe sometime for different language, you prefer to stay with your group.
Yeah.
So for me, it's not so easy to speak with the people speaking English.
Better than my Italian.
But you remember when I said to you, when James Wheaton speaking with me, I didn't understand nothing.
Even I don't understand what Wheaton's speaking about.
Nor do I.
So sometimes it's just a reason for the language you speak to have a different group. But honestly, all friend in our championship in the Superbike, and that was very, very good. During the race, everybody tried to do the best. That is normal. But finish the race, everybody sit down together.
And when you think back about your long careers, because you've had fantastic careers, the pair of you, what was the most special moment? Is it the first win? Is it the first time that you get on the podium? What is that special moment in your career, Frankie?
Sure, when you cut the finish line for first, it's something to remember. You have to remember until next one, because you have to do again. Yeah. So it's not finish. And that is when I race in every, even when I have a bad year, I believe to in the next race I can change everything. So that was my powerful, you know.
Yeah.
I don't upset when the things doesn't going well. I think next one should be better.
And how about you, Carl? What's the most special thing that you can remember? Look, I mean, you've had so many World Superbike wins. I don't know, it could have been falling off your BMX, but what's the most special moment for you?
Obviously, winning races is a special moment. I think it's when you win your first big one. And if I look at, like, I think also kind of first wins your most special win. And I think when I won the first ever World Superbike race at Donington, which was totally unexpected even from me at the time, I was on a privateer bike against all the factory bikes, and so they're special ones when you do it against the odds, and it's, you know, it kind of puts you on the world map and away you go. But like I said, there's been a few over the years. You know, winning in Australia when it went down to the very last race of the year in 1994, the other side of the world, and it was basically whoever crossed the line first in between me and American, the guy called Scott Russell, then will be world champion. So when you win in them circumstances, and, you know, it's down to the last race, they're special ones, you know. And if Brands Hatch in 95, first time I ever won a race in my life at Brands Hatch, I remember pulling the curtains back on the Sunday morning and seeing a crowd just I'd never seen before, you know. It's like, I mean, it went on to have bigger crowds in 99, like 130,000 there, but this first time at Brands, when Superbikes started becoming really big in 95, it was like 60,000, and I had a beautiful sunny day, and I won both races. It was just like the perfect day, but you know, them's the days you never forget, really.
Fantastic. And let's talk about some of your battles now. You two had some very famous battles You have some on the circuit.
Which one are you thinking about?
Well, I'm thinking about the one at Assen, which was quite incredible.
97, 99.
Yeah, which year? Well, there's that one that where famously, Frankie, you come off on the last corner. Just talk us through what was happening during that race.
Yeah, happened, I believe, to win the race and how I do in the first one. And I didn't expect the reaction from Carl so strong. And we tried to have a hard battle in the last lap. And Honestly, I at three corner to go, I overtake him. And but when I was in the last braking, I was not in the focus, and I go too much in line outside, and he come in. He was faster than me over there, and when I saw him again, I have to touch a front brake, and I crash.
I saw daylight and went for it. But it's funny because I've seen a clip of that obviously a few times, and as I got the inside in the last corner past him, as he obviously he falls down, but you can see his arm trying to grab all the way and pull me down.
Isn't it? What happened in that race? It was last lap, last race. These two were overtaking each other, bend after bend. It was absolutely incredible to watch. But what was sweet about that moment is that once you come off the mic, Frankie, on that last corner into the gravel trap, Carl went on to win the race. The Brits all climbed over the fence. It was the guys with the Union Jacks and with the St. George's Cross. Yes, they climbed over and they helped you back on your bike.
Yes, they helped me to go on the bike again, and they pushed me to the start-finish line.
And he got disqualified.
So it was incredible. People tried to help me, and the federation are disqualifying. So, because I get also 2 points because I finished 14, but no way. It was not my year.
And looking back at your careers now and coming to events like this, I know that you two are, you know, still incredibly recognisable on the world stage. Wherever you go, I mean, what does it mean to you coming out and seeing that you can draw an audience still? I mean, you put 120,000 people in Brands Hatch, and it was you that did that. And look, they're still out here, they're still interested. What does it mean to you, Carl?
They're just having to sit down and having a rest. They didn't know we were coming out, did they? It means a lot, honestly. We've been obviously next door mainly in the bike park, and like I say, the crowds are in, they were signing autographs to everybody, the queue just doesn't go down. It does make you feel special. It makes you think, well, I have done something. Obviously, people remember, because it has been quite a few years ago now. But no, it's thanks to you all for coming out and supporting us. I love it. It's great to be sort of acknowledged and sort of recognised, and still, you know, people like want to hear what you've got to say and grab a piece of you sort of all these years on. It's great, fantastic.
Do you feel old?
Yeah, I see. I'm officially old now. I didn't realise that, but classic events, classic. But that's all I get invited to these days. I'm like, shit, I'm now officially old. That's it. It's gone. It's over.
Do you still get on the bike and ride for fun, you two?
Yeah, I do a bit of off-road stuff. I've got in fact, I'm injured at the moment. I've been come off. I didn't actually come off. I twisted my heel on a motocross bike about 2 months ago. I've been obviously I don't heal as fast anymore. It's taking ages to heal. But I do a bit of off-road stuff. I have a bike for the road, but unless it's above 25 degrees, I never go out. So obviously, where I live in Blackburn, it's never above 25 degrees.
You go out twice a year then, yeah. Blackburn.
You get warm tire.
And what about you, Frankie? Do you still get on the bike?
Yeah, just 10 days ago, I was on the bike again with my son. He's just starting to be on the track. And he followed in front of me, and I was very close to go over him. But that is the rule. He is young and he wants to do it. I cannot say no. Already for 3 years I stopped a little bit this situation, but now he is 17 and he really showed me he wants to do. He wants to try, because, and I say that don't do it because I do it.
Yeah.
So if it's a pleasure for you and it's some satisfaction for you, do it. Other way, play soccer, play baseball, play tennis,
yeah,
or golf.
Yeah. Now, Carl, Christmas is coming up. I know that in my collection of DVDs on my shelf, I've probably got World Superbikes from, I don't know, 1990 up to the year 2000. I know I've got every single one of those. But I could do with something new now. I just want something new on the shelf. Surely you must have a DVD coming out.
Well, as love would have, we've got a new one coming out in this day. It's out in all available in all good shops, and probably some shit ones as well. on the 21st, it comes out. Yeah, it's called Hell for Leather 3. It's me and James Whittam doing a lot of dicking about on bikes and stuff, really. The first two DVDs are predominantly crash sort of DVDs. And this one is a bit like that. It's a lot of crash DVDs from, like, hill climbing and things like that, and obviously super bikes and stuff. But me and James also do. We go up in a plane together, which is scared. I hate flying, so that was really, it'd be entertaining to watch, because I'm just crying like a baby for, like, 40 minutes. We did a motocross race together, we did a flat track event together, we did a pit stop for one of the rides at the Isle of Man TT, so it is a really fun sort of DVD. That's
perfect Christmas present.
Absolutely perfect Christmas present, yeah.
And people can look for that. It's called Hell for Leather 3.
Yeah, Foggy and Wit. Yeah,
fantastic.
And
ladies and gentlemen, I think you've really enjoyed that, haven't you? Yeah, I think so. What I'll do, if you don't mind, is we can ask a question from the audience, Andy, is that what you're saying? sign some autographs. Yes, I think we can. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to say a huge thank you from here at the Classic Motor Show. We are so honoured to have Bowman here. Please put your hands together for Frankie Keeley. And the one and only, ladies and gentlemen, four times World Superbike champion, Mr. Carl Fogarty. Now, for your pleasure, what we're going to do is we're going to let these guys try not to escape, and they're going to stay right here and get your pens ready and be as quick as you can, because we need the stage back in about 10-15 minutes, but they're going to sign some autographs for you. Hope you